Surprise guest. Would you like to tell people who this is?
It's Dave. What's going on?
The Dave Meltzer, Wrestling Observer's Dave Meltzer. Dave, thank you for calling in, man. What a show that was yesterday, huh?
I thought so. I thought it was one of the best pay-per-views. I mean, it was top tier show. I mean, like, as far as consistent great matches one after the other, you know, you got them. You know, I mean, I think I've seen shows with more surprises, but I mean, as far as just match quality, it was one of the best shows I've ever seen. I mean, up and down, there was, you know, nothing that was less than very good, I thought, on the main show.
Yeah, I think you were talking with Brian early this morning when the show went live, and he said, you know, at least 8 of those matches are 4-star level quality matches.
Yeah, I thought so. I thought going in there was a chance to be as many as 8, and even perhaps as many as 9. And I know people who thought all 9 were, but I thought 8 of the 9 were, yeah.
So, you know, I wanted to talk to you about this because we were at All Out. Everybody was at All Out. And, you know, to watch it at home, would you say that this was a better show than All Out or kind of the same but different?
I mean, All Out, I think I would say was better because of the surprises. And the, you know, and all that. But I think that this show, from a wrestling standpoint, was a little bit better because I just thought that the Young Bucks match and the Omega and Page match, although the, you know, I mean, All Out did have that cage match, so I shouldn't even say that. I would say that, you know, but I thought the Omega Page match was fantastic. But yeah, the Lucha Brothers tag match with the Young Bucks at All Out was fantastic too. And yeah, I mean. But I would say, if I was going to say, I would say that the consistent wrestling top to bottom on this show was better, but it was pretty close. But the, you know, the four surprises, the surprises at All Out probably put it, nudged it a little ahead to me over this one.
Yeah, I mean, listen, we got 3 debuts, yeah, essentially at All Out, and it was fantastic. You know, we got CM Punk's first match, we got Danielson, and of course we got Adam Cole. Now, going into
and,
this,
and also Suzuki.
And Suzuki, too.
Yeah.
I forgot about
and Ruby too,
and Ruby as well. Oh, wow. We got
yeah. And this one we had Jay Lethal, which I mean, God bless him, but that doesn't match up to Punk and Adam Cole and Bryan Danielson.
No, it doesn't. So. You know, there were two stories with the show that really stood out, and it was the old guard and the guys that are established, like the CM Punks and the Danielsons and the Jerichos, and essentially the 4 pillars of what AEW right now sees as their future stars with Sammy, with Darby, with MJF, you know, these are with Britt Baker, you know, take Ty Conti for the women's division. You know, this is it's been interesting to see the last couple weeks of them highlighting a lot of younger talent, newer talent, non-WWE talent. You know, you spoke to Tony about this. Is this in your opinion, do you think this is the future where they're going to be focusing a little bit more on these guys to establish them on national television?
For sure. Yeah, like Dante Martin's another one.
They
gave like a big push to and everything. Yeah, I mean, it's a transition thing. I think like one of the things that we all learned from WCW, when WCW was really, really hot, is they went with the Pat Hand, and then they never really focused on the other guys. And then by the time they did, business was so far down that it was too late. And it's like, it's probably better to make these guys when you're strong than, you know, ride the old guys. Not that they're old. I mean, well, Jericho's older, but, you know, I mean, it's like you always, I think you always want that youth in there. And they're, you know, and go with the youth. You know, it's like, okay, they're not necessarily going to be as savvy, but in other ways they're going to be doing more. So take advantage of that, and yeah, and they know who the guys are. I mean, MJF was tremendous, and Darby always gets over, and you know, they put Jungle Boy over. I mean, it was the right time to put Jungle Boy over, and they did. And yeah, I expect that, you know, a lot, I expect that we will, that will be a focus, I think, of the Tony Khan, excuse me, the Tony Khan booking going forward is, you know, push, you know, whether it's Cody and Omega and these guys. And keep them strong and don't, you know, like, you know, have them win and have them lose and all that, but keep them at the top level while nudging these other guys higher and higher and higher and making new guys and making new opponents. That's the way to do it.
Dave, do you think there's going to be a ceiling at some point where they reach a limit with the number of ex-WWE guys they sign? Because they are heavily focusing on these younger talents and the quote-unquote homegrown talents. They do keep signing people, but at some point, is there going to be sort of a ceiling where they can't do that anymore?
You know, I asked that question. I never really got an answer because you would think that at some point, you know, just financially, there's when you have more guys than you can use. And I think they're already kind of at that. But
yeah.
At the same time, I think that if you there's always room for somebody who's going to be a big time player. So, I mean, to say, have they signed all the WWE guys that they would sign? I think the answer is no. But, like, I think Tony said, like, out of the 18 guys that were just cut, you know, and if they keep cutting 18 guys, there's probably going to be, you know, two or three in every one of those cuts of guys that he could come up with something to use. And so, yeah, but at some point you've got to also cut guys too. You can't keep adding and adding and adding. And he does, and he really hasn't. He's cut, like, three people in the history of the whole company, and you know, they were all either disciplinary reasons or they couldn't, you know, when I think one person's contract expired and wasn't being brought back and was in Europe at the time and things like that. But, I mean, they've never cut anyone who they were regularly working with. And at some point you have to. It's a business.
Yeah, and you know, we're going to go to a commercial break in a couple minutes, and I want to see if you could hang on for another 5 minutes with us. But, you know, this kind of goes into the discussion of, there's a lot of guys readily available to be picked up now, especially in a couple, you know, 30 days, 60 days, whatever the case may be. And, you know, there's three names that really stand out to people on that list of former WWE guys that could possibly fit in: Karrion Kross, Keith Lee, which is top on my list, and Wyndham Rotunda, where people don't know where they're going to go. I think it's an interesting thing to look at. I think for AEW, they're in a very strong position to be able to determine, you know, this guy works for me, this guy doesn't, let's try him out, because they're offering something a little bit different to a more of a hardcore audience, which I want to go into with you, Dave, because it's very important. And of course, you were at New Japan last night as well, in San Jose, right?
Yep, long day.
Very long day. We got to go to a break. Dave Meltzer on the line with us, Andrew Zarian here, Wrestling Observer Live, Sunday edition, 2 hour show. We'll be back right after this. Back, everybody. Wrestling Observer Live, Sunday edition. Andrew Zarian here. And with us, on the air, on the line, the Dave Meltzer of Wrestling Observer Newsletter. And, of course, Dave, listen, I want to go into this, but I wanted to tell you, you know, this is the IATA show is the reason why I went into broadcasting.
Wow, thank you.
It was probably 2000. I used to set my VCR to record my computer's audio, and I used to listen to Wrestling Observer when I would get home from school on VHS.
Wow.
Okay. I had the whole thing archived. I think I had like an entire year archived.
Wow.
So my entire career, my path of my career shifted at that moment. I was going to be a lawyer. Now I just talk for a living.
Wow.
It's not so much different. Dave, you know, a couple things to kind of touch on from the show. Obviously, the big story was Hangman Page and Kenny Omega in that fantastic, fantastic main event. I did not have low expectations of that match. I had very high expectations, and it far surpassed what I thought. You had brought up on Wrestling Observer Radio, and I believe the newsletter in the past you brought up, Kenny Omega's shoulders are really hurt, right?
Yeah, sometimes they're better than others. Like, whenever you're injured, you're kind of like that. And I don't know. I hadn't talked to him and asked him specifically about that in a little while. But it's been, I mean, he tore his labrum, which is a major injury. And, you know, he's been hurting for a long time. The last time we brought it up, or I asked him, he said he is feeling better. But I mean, it's still... And he told me, he goes, like, you know, I can do a great match without my shoulders. So it's like he can work. He knows how to work around it. I thought, you know, I mean, last night I saw, you know, and a lot of people saw, you know, I mean, the greatest wrestlers in the world between, you know, Bryan Danielson and the guys on and Omega and the different guys on AEW, the Young Bucks and all that, up and down the card, right, back. On New Japan, you got, you know, Okada and Ospreay, who are, you know, two of the best there are. And I thought, like, very clearly on that night last night, Omega was the best of everyone. I mean, he was put in the position. He was in the main event of the big show to change the title. It was a gigantic match for him, whereas for Danielson it was a match. But I thought that, you know, he really delivered at best-in-the-world levels, and Paige did as well. I thought that was I thought it was like a match of the year candidate.
Oh, for sure. Top tier match of the year candidate, especially in North America. You know, New Japan, you could there's numerous matches you can look at that they've had. The last year has been a little rough for them, obviously, due to the pandemic. But this was, it gave me my second wind because we were in hour like 4.5 of broadcasting the watch along, and right. I just woke up, you know, at one point during this, and I couldn't believe the match that we were seeing. So now, you know, the big question now is, what's the path for Danielson? Is it time for him to challenge immediately for this title? Is this going to be like a money in the bank type situation with the tournament where he could cash in at any time this number one contendership? Is there any kind of information as to how they're going to go down this path?
I don't know, but I'm presuming it would either be a TV main event in December or the January 8th show, which I think the January 8th show makes the most sense, you know, because I think that you want, like, the first special to have that big special match, and Danielson challenging for the title is that. And, you know, and also, it's like, Paige, you know, I mean, Paige went from an incredible match, and, you know, if to go from that match, you don't want the next match to be a letdown, and with Danielson, you know, he can do a match, you know, pretty much at that level, too. So, that's what I suspect. I suspect January 8th, but nobody's told me specifically.
Yeah, I and by the way, there's a big move happening also in January. They're going to TBS for people who don't know, and that's kind of going to change things also with TNT getting those network specials, which I'm very excited about, those quarterly specials, because it kind of adds another level to the pay-per-view cycle that they have. Rather than once a quarter, now they have, you know, they have something in between.
It's right now it's 1 hour, and I hope they can. It's weird because there's a part of me that says, well, if you're going to do like pay-per-view, like a Clash of Champions, you almost want to give it three. But then at this stage of the game, there's like a mentality, and it's not a wrong mentality, that 3 hours feels long for a television show. And usually it fades in hour three, you know, when you have a 3 hour show. So maybe 2 hours is best. But, you know, it's like 2 hours, we get that every Wednesday also.
Yeah.
So it's a weird thing. It's, I like the, I mean, I really like the idea of quarterly specials, but I don't know. And, you know, Saturday night, I mean, it's, you know, there's just a lot of different things going on. You know, I would want the quarterly specials to be the highest rated shows of all and like a pay-per-view. But right now on Saturday night, I'm not sure that's going to be the case with so much wrestling on television. So we'll have to wait and see how it all plays out. But the one thing with those shows is that they're gonna, I think, all be championship matches on those shows.
I hope so. I hope it's not like what WWE does when they have a clash of champions and there's no titles being defended.
No champions.
There's
right.
No champions. One title on the line, and that's about it.
Extreme rules with DQ finishes.
DQ, yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
You know, you brought up something interesting, and that's the Saturday time slot not being generally great for ratings. We know what they've been able to do on Saturdays due to preempted dynamites on it. But the Friday situation is a little bit more concerning to me because, you know, Friday night at 10 o'clock here on the East, not necessarily a great time slot
no.
for wrestling. And we've seen this historically. You know, when SmackDown went to Friday, a lot of people were concerned that Friday time slot, even though it's a network, you're leaving a lot of numbers on the table when you're moving from a Tuesday or a Thursday to a Friday.
Good for the network, but not for the company.
Yeah, I guess maybe not good for either one.
Yeah.
So when you look at AEW and those fast, you know, the fast nationals that are coming out, is that something that they should be concerned about, that they're not really leveling off or increasing that number? It's kind of, you know, sitting where it is and maybe dropping a little bit. Is there even a conversation to be had about moving it maybe to another day?
That's a TNT move, and I think that it won't, because I think that one of the things that they did was, you know, I mean, I think it was TBS, maybe you could have, but on TNT, I think that that's what slotted. But yeah, of course, Thursday night, if you could pick a perfect world, you would want to do it on Thursday, because that's probably the best night that's free. You could even go Monday, but I know Tony will never go on Monday because of the NFL. But I mean, yeah, Friday night and Saturday night are tough. We've seen it with the ratings that they're not going to do the numbers, because Saturday, there's so much sports you're going against. The competition, especially in football season, where you have a million college football games, so that's tough. Friday isn't as tough, but it is a bad night. I mean, it's a bad night for SmackDown, but SmackDown's on Fox, and they're still going to draw a big number on Fox, just because they're on Fox. When they were not on Fox, we saw it wasn't nearly as big a number. But, 10-10 is a lot worse than 8. So it is, yeah, no doubt it's a tough time slot. And also, the other thing, too, is for the Friday show, I think that it's like Tony books in a certain way, and it's like it's everything, you know, it's like he wants the young guys on TV, and that's a lot of what he wants now. But when you do that, you are sacrificing ratings, you know, because like he could throw Eddie Kingston and Omega and the Young Bucks and all these guys and try to load those shows up with the big names. Kind of like what Vince honestly will do on a Monday, you know, you're always going to have that, you know, main event thing. And I think that, you know, he is really into building a lot of young guys, and you do sacrifice ratings short term with the idea that you're building for the long term, which is actually a positive thing. So sometimes when I see the ratings down, I go, you know, he is building for the future, and these are not like the Wednesday, this last Wednesday show, which I thought was an excellent show, but I also thought going in the ratings aren't going to be that great. This is because it's not, you know, Dax Harwood and Pac, which was a fantastic match, but that's not a match that's going to draw big ratings, nor did it. So you're kind of like, you've got two things that you're trying to do, and or many things, really. You're trying to have a great show. You're trying to build a pay-per-view. You're trying to elevate young talent. And you're trying to get ratings. And they are not all the same thing. And, you know, I mean, but yeah, the ratings were very, very strong in September, and they're not as strong now. And there's a bunch of reasons, including other sports is a lot of it. But it's a little bit of I do feel a little bit of burnout though from so much television. I think that's part of it, and that's going to make it tough. And the other thing too is I think it's tougher for, you know, it's tough for WWE and it's tougher for AEW. But one of the things that I was kind of thinking about is that like a lot of AEW fans, not most, but a good percentage of AEW fans do watch WWE programming. A very small percentage of WWE fans watch AEW programming. So for the people, you know, that let's say 35% of the AEW audience that also watches WWE, this is a real burnout. You know, when you're talking about 4 or 5 nights a week, it's tough, especially Friday night for a B show.
Yeah. Becomes a part-time, you know, job.
Right. I mean, it's just there's so much. If you are only an AEW fan, not quite as bad. It's only Wednesday and Friday and then occasional pay-per-view. If you're only a WWE fan, it's not quite as bad. But for those people who are fans of everything, it is too much. You can't watch all of it and have any kind of a life, and that is, you know, that's a concern. Plus, again, a lot of these fans are fans of whether it's NBA or UFC or NFL, and that's time consuming as well.
Yeah, and this is part of the game now, right?
Also, your family and children too.
Your family and children as well.
Aside from the TV,
yeah.
There's a lot of obligations.
Right. Yeah. I mean, it's just and there's so many alternative things going on. It's tough. Everyone's trying to carve in their place, and it is very much, I mean, a lot of times when we talk about AEW and in WWE as well, and you go, oh, they're not getting the hardcores, and it's, I mean, the casuals, and it's like the casuals have find 500 other things that they like to do, whether it's movies or whatever. It's really going to be tough to draw casual fans week after week. You can draw some every now and then, but when you're having that much television, you're really relying on hardcores in both cases.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Dave Meltzer, everybody. Dave, thank you for calling in. We got to go to break, but absolutely love getting your opinion, hearing from you, and hopefully we'll do it again in a couple weeks.
Okay, cool.
Love it. Dave Meltzer, everybody. Wrestling Observer Live. We'll be right back after this.
Again, maybe it's just that as a Canadian who has always had health insurance, this doesn't seem, Max, smarten up, to be a big deal.
This is going to go to the best of right here, Lance.
Yeah.
You're being corralled away by this dog.
By a dog trying to eat my wife's boots.
Oh, man. Oh, they said they must be tasty.
Yeah, if my wife gets home and her good leather boots are chewed up, I'm dead.
You'll be chewed up next.
Yeah, I'll be living outside with the dog.
If you enjoy these videos, for just $7.99 per month, you can enjoy full-length editions of The Brian and Vinny Show, Wrestling Observer Live, Figure Four Daily with Tom Lawler and Lance Storm, The Mad Men Podcast, Speak Now Pro Wrestling with Denise Salcedo and more, plus hundreds of archived shows, all in beautiful HD. Don't miss out. Join us today.